lots of stuff just to set up a NAS. If you remember from my last video, I got really fed up with my whole file management workflow and decided to finally do something about it. I figured the Synology 1819 Plus would be a perfect fit for my needs. So in this video, I'll show you how I've set up things, what are the good and bad things about it, and if it was the right choice. Unlike a simple external disk, a NAS requires a few more things than just the USB and the power cable. Thankfully, it's not overly complicated, but you need to be aware of all the components required because it's easy to lose count, especially if it's the first time you set up something like this. So let's see what's needed. I'll have a list of everything as affiliate links in the description below, so if you're looking to build a similar setup, you can just use those as a reference. Of course, the obvious part is the actual NAS and hard drives. As I mentioned before, the NAS was the 8-bay 1819 Plus, and for the hard drives I went with 5 12TB Western Digital Reds, the 5400rpm version just to cut down on the noise. The trickier part were the components required for everything to talk to each other. It's nothing ridiculously complex, but it was my first time setting up a NAS, so I had to do a little bit of research. I wanted a fast connection between the NAS and the computers, and unfortunately the default speed of the Synology 1819 Plus is just 1 gigabit per second, so I needed to get a 10 gigabit card. I went with Synology's SFP version, which was ridiculously expensive, but I just wanted to avoid the hassle of having to return components, so I just threw money at the problem. But you can easily get a third-party card for much, much less, so you should probably not repeat my mistake. Thankfully, the iMac Pros already have a 10 gig Ethernet connection, so there's no extra hardware needed there. I could connect the NAS straight to the iMacs, but I decided to network everything the proper way, so in order to do that, I also had to get a 10 gig switch since my router is not anywhere close to those speeds. I went with this switch from Mikrotik. It allows the NAS and the two iMacs to talk together in 10 gig speeds, and the rest of the network can continue talking in 1 gig speeds. The reason I went with the Mikrotik was A, the price, which was just 130 euros on Amazon, but most importantly because it's silent. It's not using a fan at all. As I found out though, it runs hot. So if you're concerned about heat and the longevity of your switch, you might want to invest on another one that has a fan to cool things off. It's been running for days though, without any issues, so I wouldn't be too concerned about that. Now, how does everything connect to each other? To connect the switch to the router, I just needed a regular Ethernet cable. I just used the one that came with the NAS. All other connections coming out of the switch are in SFP. The 10 gig card on the NAS already has an SFP connection, but the iMacs just have a regular Ethernet connection, so I needed a couple of adapters there. These are called transceivers, and they basically convert the SFP connection to Ethernet. You might think this is a cheap adapter, but each one of those transceivers costs a little bit more than 60 euros. And since I need two of them, that's 130 euros just for these two adapters. And you thought Apple was the one with the ridiculously expensive accessories. Of course, an SFP cable is also required to connect the NAS to the switch, which is another ridiculously expensive accessory. This was the one cable I forgot to buy, and of course I only realized that while setting everything up. Just a meter of it is more than 20 euros. Finally, the last thing needed are the Ethernet cables. To get the 10 gig speeds, I went with Cat7 cables. Thankfully, these are the cheapest items of the whole setup. The memory was a little bit tricky to figure out, but I only have myself to blame for that. If I checked the compatibility list beforehand, I wouldn't have any issues. I first ordered two 8GB sticks for a total of 16GB of memory, but it turns out on the 1819 Plus, you can either have two 4GB sticks or two 16GB sticks. I wouldn't have imagined that a limitation like that would ever exist, but it looks like Synology wants to not have to worry about all sorts of variables, so it limits the type and size of memory used on their systems. With the 16GB sticks, the NAS wouldn't boot at all. For now, I'm just using the default 4GB of memory the system came with, and I'm waiting for two 4GB sticks to arrive. Hopefully, this will work out without any issues.
Okay, the moment of truth.
So the whole memory thing is something to keep in mind before purchasing. Do not forget to check the compatibility list. The good thing is that there's absolutely zero knowledge required to set the network up. Basically, everything is automatically set up. The switch and the router automatically assign the IPs, and the computers and NAS can immediately start talking to each other. The same applies for the first setup of the NAS. You just need to go through some initial steps, and the NAS handles the rest. I'm sure trying to do the same thing 20 years ago would be a much bigger hassle. It's ridiculous how simple everything was. It's kind of like plug and play. The one thing though that took a really long time was the time needed to set up the RAID, transfer the data, and expand the array. This whole process took somewhere around 9 to 10 days, maybe a little bit longer, I don't remember exactly. I knew this would be the case, but it was still annoying to deal with. The initial setup of the SHR2 array took approximately 2 days. The cause of this was the parity consistency check the drives had to go through, but I'm not sure this had to be done though, because the drives were completely empty. Maybe it was an error on my side, but yeah, the first 2 days I didn't really do anything with the system. And then I had the laborious task of moving the actual data to the NAS. It took easily 5 or so days to do that. It's kind of partially my fault, but not entirely. So here's what happened. I've upgraded both iMacs to Big Sur, and unfortunately the Drobo that has all of my data couldn't be recognized by the system at all, which is another reason not to get a DAS that requires drivers. So what I had to do was connect the Drobo to an earlier version of OS X, but on a computer with a slower Ethernet connection, which meant transferring data at around 100 megabytes per second. Moving 18 terabytes of data at those speeds just takes an insanely long time. I thought I would never finish moving the data. And then after the data transfer, I wanted to add the additional 12 terabyte drive from the Drobo to the Synology. I can only move it though, only after the data transfer from the Drobo to the Synology was complete. Of course, that meant the NAS had to go through another rebuild process. That was an extra 2.5 to 3 days. Something like that. All in all, I spent 10 or so days setting everything up and making sure that there's no corrupted data. I used Beyond Compare for that, which was incredibly helpful. It's a nice little utility where you drop two folders side by side and then the program compares them. It looks for files or size inconsistencies, and you can really easily correct issues if that happens. So now that everything is all set up, how does it feel? One word, amazing. It cost an arm and a leg to get the system the way I wanted, but it's truly worth the investment. I don't need to think anymore where a file is and on which computer. There's one central place where everything is stored, and it can be accessed by every single device in my office. For example, if I want to work from my iPad, I can just grab the file I need, edit it, or do whatever else with it, and then put it back on the NAS. It's really the best way to deal with your files. Once I started using the system, I've also noticed a change in the way I work. Let's take as an example my videos on YouTube. Before, I only worked on one video at a time. I was using a 2TB SSD, and to make sure the SSD had the space needed to edit that project, I was always careful to only add the data I needed for that one project. So even if I was fed up with a video I was working on, I had to first finish it up, publish it, move the data to the Drobo, and then start working on the next video. I was constrained by my file management decisions and not other more important reasons like creativity. Now the process feels much more organic. I can work on as many projects as I want and have them in different states of completion. I just dump all the data for the project on the NAS, and whenever I need to access them, I can do it without having to shuffle things around. The NAS is always on and always accessible. On top of that, now when I'm working on a project, I always have a backup of the state I'm in on two locations, the SSD drive and the NAS. Before, I only had a copy of the project on the SSD, which made me really uncomfortable. If the SSD got corrupted, or something like that, it meant the project was completely gone. Now, if something like that happens, I can just revert back to the previously saved state on the NAS. The other big topic for me was the noise. I didn't want to have a noisy system like the Drobo 5D3. I was a little bit afraid that that would be the case, but thankfully the 1819 Plus is nothing like the annoyingly noisy 5D3. From where I'm working, the sound is quite subdued. It's maybe 3 meters away from me, and most of the times I have to pay attention to it to notice it. The noise coming out of it is not as much in your face as it was with the annoying vibrating sounds of the Drobo. So in a scale from 1 to 10, the noise level of the Synology is somewhere around 2 to 3. When the drives are in sleep mode, the noise is around 1 out of 10. In comparison, the Drobo would be a solid 10. Whether the drives were in sleep mode or not, it was absolutely terrible. The vibrating of the case and the noise of the fans could just drive you insane. And that was basically the reason I had it turned off most of the times. Now the Synology is turned on 24/7, and if I want to work at 2 in the morning where there's complete silence, well, as silent as a busy city can be, I can do that without having to deal with additional noise from the NAS. And all that with the default fans that come with the device. There are some users who have replaced theirs with even more silent Noctua fans, and they seem to be incredibly happy with it. So if at some point I need to reduce the noise level even more, I could do that. But for now, I'm good. There is a bit of vibration noise when all drives are active, but it has to do with the surface the NAS is on. The interesting thing is that it's only audible from a very specific distance, around a meter or so, and also from a specific angle. From where I'm working, I don't really notice it, but if I move closer and also angle myself in a specific way, I can hear it. It doesn't really bother me, but I want to see if I can get rid of that sound completely, so I also bought an anti-vibration mat, which hopefully will solve that issue. It might be a placebo effect, but I kind of think that this material works. It kind of muffles the vibration. I can still hear it, but it's not as intense as before. I don't know. It remains to be seen. The final thing I want to mention is how easy the whole backing up of the system actually is. I basically connect an external drive to the NAS, and depending on the drive connected, it backs up specific folders to it. It's really amazing. You can also back up to the cloud or to other Synology devices, set up schedules, check for file integrity. It's absolutely awesome what you can do with it. At the moment, I'm still in the process of cleaning up all of my files and setting things up the way I want to, so my backups at the moment are a bit messy, but once I clean things up, I'm planning to use a couple of external drives to save different bits of data to them. As you can see, almost 3 weeks in, and I'm still working on my whole file workflow, but in the end, it will be worth it. I still need to set up a couple more things like jumbo frames, which basically means increasing the packet size and as a result increasing the data transfer speed. At the moment I'm somewhere around 300 megabytes per second read and write, so that can be improved even further. I'm absolutely fine with that speed, but it can get better, so in due time I will set that up as well. And I think that about covers my journey into NAS land. Overall, I'm very happy with the purchase, and I would definitely encourage you to start thinking about your storage and file management workflow. It doesn't mean you also need an 8-bay NAS, but I think a NAS, however big or small, is an absolutely awesome device to have. And with that, we've reached the end of this video. Hope you managed to get some good ideas out of it. Take care, and I'll see you on the next one.